well? It's good to be seen. This is the afternoon and the evening that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Let's put our hands together and give God some praise. Why should we give him some praise? Because the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. The question is, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? You got to have clean hands and a pure heart. Amen? And how do we get to that pure hands? And how do we get to that level of purity? The songwriter said, what can wash away my sins? What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood. How many know the blood still works? It still works. It still works. We used to sing an old hymn that says, I know it was the blood. Hallelujah. We're gathered here today to celebrate and memorialize the death and the burial and the resurrection of our living Savior. Well, you asked me, well, how do we know that he's living? Because I talked to him this morning. I talked to him this afternoon. Anybody talk to him? Can't witness to the fact that he's still alive? All right. In fact, I talked to him right before I got up here. So I know we serve a living and alive Savior. Amen? Stand with me, if you will, if you'd be so kind and reverence as we open up in prayer. Our Father and our God, we're so grateful for the privilege that it is to come into your presence. Oh God, we are thankful for your mercy, thankful for your grace. Lord, for it was because of your mercy that you didn't give us what we justly deserve. We thank you, Lord, that you died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. You snatched us out of darkness and you brought us into the marvelous light. Oh God, we were just wretches undone. We were in our sins, we were lost, but you came and found us. And Lord, we are so grateful that we won't take this opportunity to say thank you. Oh God, we weren't even conscious of the fact that we needed a Savior. But Lord, you died while we were yet sinners. So Lord, tonight we ask that God the Holy Spirit would be present. Oh God, we ask that you would cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You said if we would confess our sins, you'd be faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God, would you restore our fellowship? Lord, would you fill us afresh? And Lord, that you would help us to hear, as the man of God preaches tonight, that you would hear, we would help us to hear what you have to say to us. And then, Lord, let us not be ashamed to open our mouths and give you some praise because of what you've done. God, you've been so good to us. And Lord, we can't even breathe, take one step before the other, if it's not because of your mercy and your grace. Bless now everything that will be done in this service. May it be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus Christ's name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Please remain standing, if you will, as we read our responsive reading. Our responsive reading will come from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 34. We'll read responsively, and then we'll close together. Verse 23 says, For I received of the Lord what also I passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.
For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks of the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ, eat and drink judgment on themselves. But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather to eat, you should all eat together. And then verse 34, all together. Anyone who is hungry should eat something at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give further directions. Amen. May the Lord add a blessing unto the reading of his word. Remain standing. Remain standing. I don't want to keep you going up and down. We're going to, our next, we will have a kind of a melody of congregational hymn. We'll sing, Lead Me to Calvary. And then we'll sing another hymn, and then we'll sing another hymn. It'll be three hymns all together. Amen? Amen. Well, just like when we get to heaven, we'll be singing hymns. Amen? Amen.
Hymns at the church. Everybody, King of my life,
King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall the glory be.
Lest I forget,
lest I forget, thy throne crown brown. Lead me to Calvary.
Come on, lest I forget,
lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary.
Show me the tomb.
Show me the tomb where thou was laid. Tenderly mourn and wept. Angels in robes of light array guarded thy thrift, may I slept.
Lest I forget,
lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to God.
Come on, let's sing that one more time. Lest I forget,
lest I forget Gethsemane,
lest I forget,
lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary.
Earth,
hear his voice. Praise the Lord. the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the of blood to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus. Father, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great.
Come on, everybody.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father. Son, and give him the glory. Great things he has done.
Hallelujah.
I love this hymn. I serve a risen Savior. I serve a risen Savior. He's in this world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I hear his voice of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. See his loving care, and though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. Through all the stormy blasts, the day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. Walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart.
Come on, everybody, he lives.
With me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, he lives.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. You may be seated. We serve a risen and alive Savior. You ask me how I know he lives? Because I talked to him. Told you, I talked to him when I came up here. Talked to him last night. And when it's time, when you have those nights where you can't go to sleep, or when you have those nights, you wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm gonna tell you right now, you don't need no lanotonin or whatever you call it, luminin or whatever. Just have a talk with Jesus. Tell him all about your problems. And if you ain't got no problem, just go ahead and talk to him anyway. He will rock you back to sleep. And sometimes we just need, the Lord just woke you up. This is spend more time. You know, I need to talk to you a little bit. I couldn't get you during the day. I couldn't get you after lunch. I couldn't get you after dinner. But now I want to wake you up. I'm just waking you up to let just to talk to me. The awesome thing about God is from Genesis to Revelation, the creator of the universe desires fellowship with the creation. Even though we may not want it, even though we sometimes ignore God, we get up in the morning and not speak to him. We go throughout our day and sometimes we don't talk to him, but he's always desiring to fellowship with us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. At this time, we want to take this opportunity to welcome all of our visitors, whether you're on the first floor or on the balcony. We're not going to embarrass you. We want to take this time just to welcome you. Would you be so kind, please, ma'am, please, sir, just to stand where you are. I'm not going to ask you to say anything. We just want to acknowledge you. Amen. Amen. Could you just remain standing for a second? Remain standing for 1 second. The ushers are going to come, and they're going to give you a connect card. Christian Stronghold, could you show love to our visitors, please? Amen. 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 The card that you just received, if you'd be so kind just to fill out that card, that's our connect card. That's how we connect with you. Fill it out. If be so kind to drop it in the offering baskets when the deacons come around to collect the offering. That is how we correspond with you. As a result of you filling out that card, you'll get some correspondence back from us to share more about Christian Stronghold. But we pray that you be blessed by the hospitality of the saints that are around you, blessed by the preached word as it comes from our own Reverend Kim Perrone. And we pray that you be blessed by the worship as we're led in worship by our music ministry tonight. And if you're ever in the area, please, please come and join us for worship again. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now we'll have our presentation of candidates for membership by our Deacon Baker.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I try to have a little comment before each presentation, before the candidate presenting the candidates. And I just want to say this conversation is for all the men in the audience. 45 days ago, I completed my final treatment for prostate cancer. And I just want all the men to know, get your blood work done, get your PSA number, and get tested, because in going through the 45 days of treatment, the radiologist said there are a lot of black men who are not being treated. But I just also want to say, if Lorette McNair's here, her brother was my student at Overbrook, and he passed away from prostate cancer at 53. So that encouraged me, you know, and I wish I could have done more for him, but he encouraged me that I need to go on. So I'm encouraging all men here, and wives, tell your husbands, go get your numbers checked out. So on that note, I'd like to present the candidates for today. The first candidate is, I know I'm going to mess up on your first name, so I'm just going to call you by your last name, Mr. Adams. Quasim Adams. Muwahid Bingham. Diane Angel Billups. and Joseph Harley. I need a motion from the floor to accept these candidates for full-fledged membership at Christian Stronghold Church. Please stand and state your name loud and clear. Also, your PIN number to your bank account. Oh, that was my writing, sorry. Do we have a second? It has been properly moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Ayes have it, so ordered.
It's always good to welcome new candidates into the fellowship and into the family. Amen?
Amen.
We got some new family members. Amen. 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 Anybody glad to be a part of Stronghold?
Amen.
I know I got some people. It may not be everybody, but I know where I was before I came to Stronghold. Now, if you remember where you were before you came. But in the Revelation chapter 3, the Bible says that God was saying to a church, he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens the door, I will come in and sup with him and he with me." You know, you've read that for evangelism, but the context of the passage was Jesus really saying, "I'm on the outside. What y'all doing inside look good, but guess what? I ain't in." And the what God has blessed us, there are different churches across the world, across the country. The Holy Spirit is still active at Christian Stronghold. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. People are still getting saved. Lives are still being transformed, and people are still growing. Amen?
Amen.
So the reach, restore, and revitalize. I got it. All those three R's, they still working because of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. The three R's work because of just the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. Amen. As we prepare for the offering, our offering scripture will come from Psalms 96, verse 8. Would you be so kind to please stand in reverence for the word? Psalms 96, verse 8, in NIV, it says, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts." You may be seated.
Amen.
This scripture reminds us that giving is an act of worship. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So at this time, we want to remind those who are giving that our pastor, Christopher Bell, does not receive a salary. He receives gifts of love from the congregation. So ushers, just hold up for 1 second. Just stand where you are. Just don't move. Don't move. Just freeze real quick. Don't go nowhere. Just stay right there. So we want to make sure that we take care of our pastor. Amen?
Yeah.
There are ushers that are standing there frozen right now, like Simon says. But they have a blue envelope. If you forgot your offering, you don't know how to give on the Realm app, they are raising up an envelope. Just raise your hand, and they'll give you a blue envelope. Secondly, we have one of our own, Reverend Kim Perrone, is our preacher for this evening. Amen. If you don't know how to give online or whatever, you can give through an envelope. There's a green envelope. If you need an envelope of any kind, or tithes and offerings, on our white envelope. And also, there is a communion offering tonight for the less fortunate, or our benevolent offering. That is a yellow envelope. If you need any of those envelopes, if you forgot your checkbook or whatever, you can give online. But if you want to give in the building, we're here to open, make sure there's many opportunities as present. Just raise your hand. The ushers will come over, and they will give you an envelope. Okay, you can go, ushers. Amen. Amen. And members, we want to take this opportunity. Please, those of you who know Realm, please check in. And I'll do a selfish plug tonight. You know, we had our Right Now Media launch last week.
Yeah.
And the Right Now Media people registered today. And we met our goal. Team, we met our goal. Amen. 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 So that means that between when the last time we had our meeting, our team meeting, and now, this Sunday, it means about 200 and something people also registered. We had two something already registered, so we had another 200 that were registered. Let's praise the Lord for that. Amen. Pastor Bell decided to give us a free subscription. That subscription never runs out. It's yours. Amen? Amen. So at this time, I would ask the deacons that they would come. You'll see some, those of you who are online with us and those of you who are in the building, you'll see some announcements that will come forth while the deacons are taking the offering. God, we are so grateful for you told us in your word that you give man the ability to gain wealth. And then, Lord, not only do you give us the ability to gain wealth, but, Lord, you give us the opportunity to give back to you a portion of what you've given to us. So would you bless this offering now? Again, give us the wisdom to use it to advance your kingdom. We ask these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
I have the privilege to introduce to some of us, and to present to others, us members, our own Reverend Ken Perrone. Amen. Amen. He joined Christian Stronghold in 1994. He currently serves as the superintendent of Sunday school. And as a cell leader and a coach, he's also serves as in the men's breakfast ministry and is a former Sunday school teacher, youth disciple, a CBI instructor, and a certified biblical counselor, currently serving in Christian Stronghold's counseling ministry as a senior counselor. Reverend Perrone and his college sweetheart, Sherry, have been married for 38 years.
Amen.
Amen. You don't look that old, do we? And They are proud parents of two adult children, Deanna and Austin. If anybody, if you know him, you know he loves to fish.
Yes.
You know, he goes all these places, yeah. Even comes, has the nerve to come down to Delaware,
yeah.
Goes fishing, and never lets me know, yo, man, I'm going down to, you know. And then, you know, every time he goes fishing, he sends me these needling type text messages with a picture of him standing next to this huge fish. Never said, yo, man, I'm going fishing, let me know, you know what I'm saying? But he did let me know the last time he was coming down to buy some fishing gear. Thanks, appreciate it, you know. We went to school together at PBU or Karen or whatever it's called now. And we always have shared our friendship and the fellowship. We used to both have long commutes. That's another thing. We praise the Lord that he was able to retire this year. Amen. Let's praise the Lord. Amen. That means, Sherry, he's going to be home every day. I understand. I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you. If you're like my wife was not excited when I stopped traveling either. She was like, you're going to be home every night? I thought she was going to be excited, you know. But again, if you, you know, y'all know me, you know, that you know, I'm special, so you know. As he comes tonight, I pray that you would pray for yourselves. John says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Lord has to say. And then also pray for him that the Lord would give him power to preach the word and to allow the Holy Spirit to use him to tell us what thus saith the Lord. So the next voice you will hear after our music ministry selection will be that of our own Pastor Ken, Reverend Ken Perrone. You know, he's an overseer. He's an overseer. He oversees the Sunday school ministry and everything else. So that's correct. But after that, please give him a Christian Stronghold welcome when he comes. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
I didn't hear you. Good evening, Stronghold.
Good evening.
So this is what we're going to do tonight, okay? Somebody next to you, somebody online needs to hear your testimony. So what we're going to do is, right, I'm going to start, and then I'm going to cue y'all in. And we're going to sing so that the people online can hear you. Now, right now, all they hear is me. So that means you guys really got to sing from your soul. Is that all right? All right, y'all, let's get started. It's okay to clap. Come on, y'all. Hasn't God been good to you? God is the joy and the strength of my life. And strife, he promised to keep me, never to leave me. He never, ever come short of his word. I confess and pray, stay in the narrow way. I gotta keep my life clean every day. I wanna go with him when he comes back. The joy and strength of my life. I can't hear you. He moves all pain, misery, and strife. He promised to keep me, never to leave. Look at him. Never, ever come short of his word. I've got the fast, dead brain, stay in the narrow way. I've got to keep my life clean every day. I want to go. Comes back, I've come too far, and I'll never turn back. Is that all right? God is the joy, the strength of my life. He moved all pain, misery, and strife. He promised to keep me, never to leave me. He's never, ever come short of his word. I ain't gotta fast and pray and stay in the narrow way. I got to keep my life clean every day. I wanna go with him when he comes back. I come to fall and I'm never turning back. Oh, oh, my God, he is. 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 Oh, God is my all. Oh, oh, my all and all. Come on, y'all. My all and all. Somebody needs to hear all and all. Come on, y'all. My all and all. 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 One more time. God is, oh, God is, oh, God is, oh, God is, oh, God is my own.
God is my all and all. Is he your all and all? I am so grateful and humbled to be here once again. I just want to give all honor and praise to my Lord and Savior for another opportunity to stand before you, and to our pastor in his absence, once again, allowing me to handle his congregation. As I always say, you are his prized possession. And if you have anything that you value, you just don't allow anybody and everybody to handle it. But he has entrusted me with this opportunity to stand before you, and I thank him once again for that opportunity. I thank you for being here. I mean, you could have been anywhere this evening, but you chose to be here, and I am thankful for that as well. I'm also thankful. I think I have half of my two children here. My daughter, she's up in the balcony. You know, they get on me when I embarrass them, but, you know, I always say I'm so proud, so I always want to acknowledge them. I have my mother here who's with me. And I also have my wife of not 38, but 42 years. I need to update that bio. That is off by a few years. It is 42. We celebrated in November. So, Sheree, would you please stand so that they can see you? Amen, amen. Now, I did retire March 1st. I did come out. And for those of you who know, I had a 4-hour commute. So my work day was basically 12 hours. And now that I retired, I thought I would reclaim 12 hours of my day. Well, let me tell you, I'm ready to go back to work because I don't have time to do anything that I want to do. No, it's all good. I'm enjoying retirement. I'm enjoying being home. I think I just passed the threshold. I think she gave me 30 days. So I just passed 30 days and she hasn't kicked me out yet. So I'm still at home. I'm still at home. I'm still trying to work through that honey-do list of over 30 years of not getting it done. So that is what I'm working on. Amen? Amen. Well, you read into your hearing tonight part of my text, and I want to take a look at 1 Corinthians 11, verses 24 and 25. And it says, "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood.'" And tonight, we want to talk about a seat at the table. And when you hear that phrase, what comes to mind? Now, for me, I thought a corporate setting. You know, all the big wigs from the C office, the C-suite or whatever, sitting around the table. They have a seat at the table. They're the ones who's in charge of the corporation. They're the ones who's making directions. Or you could think about a board where you have board members that sit around the table. They got their seat at the table either through philanthropy or because of a name or because of their the field that they work in. They're an expert in that field, so they got a seat at the table because of their expertise. Or then you could think about, from a socioeconomic standpoint, a level playing field, equal opportunity. I think about Reverend Brown and his wife Shamika. He's on the county commissioner board, I believe, and she's on the school board. So they've got a seat at the table to make decisions about the welfare of their community. But tonight, we're going to talk about a different seat at the table. We're going to talk about when you come to the Lord's table, the seat that you have at the Lord's table. And I want you to understand that it's one of the most important aspects of our Christian life. And I would dare say that many Christians take it too lightly, or they fail to understand the significance of what it means to come to the Lord's table. That's why in 1 Corinthians 11:30 it says that many are weak and sickly and some sleep, because they fail to do a thorough examination of the sin in their lives and what table they're sitting at. See, you can either sit at the Lord's table or you can sit at the devil's table. But you got to make a choice. You can't sit at both. You're either going to love the one and hate the other, or you're going to hate the one and love the other, but you got to make a choice as to what table and what seat you're going to be seated in. You need to understand that your seat was paid for. Not by money, not by works. Your seat was paid for by a broken body and shed blood for the remission of your sins. You could go to a 5-star Michelin restaurant. You can go to Paris, Italy, New York, wherever there is a 5-star restaurant, and the seat that you have tonight will not compare to the seat that you have tonight. that meal will not be as good as the meal. The piece of bread and the wine that you're going to get tonight is far more expensive and better than if you went to a five-star restaurant. So tonight, we want to look at four things associated with your seat at the table. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Let's pray. Our God and our Father, we thank you. And we praise your holy name once again, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord. We thank you for just to be able to come and have a seat at your table, Lord, to be able to partake of communion tonight, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would use me tonight, Lord, that you would increase and I would decrease, Lord, and that you would fill me afresh with your Holy Spirit, Lord. I am in need. I am inadequate, Lord, without your power. So, Lord, I'm asking that you would fill me afresh this evening, Lord. Speak through me, Lord. Have your way, and we'll be ever so careful to thank you and to praise you. For it's in Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now, a while ago, my wife came to me and said she wanted to watch this series on TV. And when she told me the name, I kind of looked, you know, kind of like, that's not something you normally would want to watch. And I kind of let it go, and she came back a couple of weeks later and said, you know, I want to watch the series. And I'm like, okay, you know, I wasn't putting it off, but I wasn't eager. I'd heard about it. I'd heard a lot of good comments about it, but I just didn't think that was something that she would want to watch. So I called a buddy of mine, Mike, in Houston, and he said, oh, man, that's the greatest show, man. I love that show, man. So I said, all right. And I couldn't see him watching it either. So it must be me, you know, the two of them, but it must be me. So we started watching the show, and after about the second episode, I called him and I said, dude, the things that they're doing in this show, I can't believe. I mean, there's one family, in two episodes, they had killed like 12 people. And I'm thinking, you know, and they get away with it, you know, and the cops look the other way, and I'm just like, okay. And then I had to think about, okay, it's a show. It's a TV show. It's made for TV. And I don't want to give it away in case somebody ever wants to watch it. But it's a series about a family that has this large amount of land. And the father, the patriarch, is doing everything in his power to protect this land. He wants to leave it as an inheritance, a legacy to his children. And that was the thing that drew my buddy, Mike, to it. It was about that inheritance. It was about the legacy, because he could identify with that because of what his great-grandfather and grandfather did. So, long story short, they got this big house, and they got this big dining room and dining room table in there. And every time you see it, this table is fully set out. I mean, it's got everything on it. As a matter of fact, the daughter one time said, she couldn't understand why they had so much stuff on the table. They had caviar knives, and they don't even eat caviar. So for her, it didn't make sense. So one day, you know, she comes down, and her father's sitting there, and she says, what's the point of having all this stuff on the table? Why do we have all? There's nobody here but just us two, but you got a seating for 12 people. And he looked at her, and he said, doesn't matter how many people sit at the table. It matters that you have a place at the table. It's not about the table or where it is, and I'm adding my own two cents now. It's not about where it is, but it's that you have a seat at the table. And isn't that what Jesus did for us? Does he not provide a seat at the table for us? It's not about the table that they're going to pull out later on this evening. It's not about that table. As a matter of fact, a few years ago during COVID, we weren't even in here when we had communion. So it doesn't matter where the table is. It doesn't matter what's on the table. What matters is that you've got a seat at the table. So the first thing we want to look at then is you have to accept your invitation to a seat at the table. Now, Pastor Taylor, you'll appreciate this. and all the other ministers in here, when you're looking for an illustration, and sometimes you don't want to just use a generic illustration, just like I was doing with this TV series, so to speak, but then God gives you a real life illustration. The other morning, I'm walking my dog, and we're on our way home, and my neighbor is coming down the street. He's on his way to catch the L to go to work, and as he passed me, he says, "Hey, have you heard about this foundation?" I'm like, "No, I'm not familiar." He said, "Well, my firm started this foundation, and we're having this function, and I want to give you and your wife a seat or a ticket to come and sit at my table." And I'm like, "What? Did that just drop out of the, you know, a seat at his table? His firm is putting on a function. He's inviting me to come and to sit at his table. Isn't that what God does? Does he not invite us to come and sit at his table? He gives us an invitation. He said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me." In Matthew chapter 9, Jesus was calling his disciples, and he saw Matthew sitting there at his tax booth collecting taxes. And what did he say to him? He said, "Come, follow me." That was an invitation. Come, follow me. What does Matthew do? He invites Jesus to his house. Jesus comes to dinner. Who's sitting at the table? Other tax collectors? Publicans? Prostitutes? And Jesus. Jesus sat at the table with sinners. Well, what are we? When he invited us to his table, who is he sitting with? Is he not sitting with sinners? Are we not? What did the Pharisees say? Why is he sitting at the table with sinners? Because Jesus said, "I didn't come to save the righteous. I came to save and seek that which was lost." He came to meet us where we are in our sinful state, to sit us at his table that we might dine with him. You don't have to clean up. You don't have to dress up. You don't have to pretend. You can come as you are to his table. In Revelation 3:20, Pastor Taylor was just talking about it. He says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." He's on the outside. He wants to come in. But guess what? When he comes in, when you hear that voice and you invite him in, he will come in and eat with you. That means he's going to be at the table with you. That means you're going to have a seat. But guess what? It's not your table. It's his table. He's going to bring the table when he comes in, and he's going to bring the food, because he said, "I'm the bread of life." Yeah. So not only does he provide a table, but he provides the food for you to eat. Once you've accepted the call or the invitation from Jesus to come to the table, it doesn't matter what table you're at. I can't go to my friend's function and say, "Hey, I don't want to sit at this table. I want to go sit over here at somebody else's table. I don't want to be with you. I've got to sit at his table, because he paid for my seat. Jesus paid for our seat, so we can't go and sit at somebody else's table, because you've got a seat with your name on it. Jesus paid for your seat. He paid with his body and his blood. The next thing we want to look at, after you've accepted the invitation, is that you've got to pay attention at the table. You've seen, like, a wedding, you've seen the party planner at a function, you know, that person who's running around trying to make sure everything is in place. They're making sure that the flowers are in place, the place settings are right, the food is right. You know, they're paying attention to everything but the person who might be speaking That's not their focus. Their focus is on everything else but that. And we see that when Martha and Mary invited Jesus to their house. What was Martha worried about? What was she doing? She was worried about all the other things. She was worried about making sure that the place settings were right. She was worried about the food. She was worried about the house being clean. And so much so that she asked Jesus, say, hey, tell my sister to come and help me. But what did Jesus say? He said, no, only one thing is necessary. And that is for her to sit at my feet and listen. And that's what we need to do when we're at the table. We need to listen. We need to pay attention to Jesus. We need to focus on him. We should have a singular focus. There shouldn't be any other things going on but our paying attention to Jesus. Martha was distracted. She was full of anxiety. You don't want to be that person. You don't want to be that distraction for somebody else who needs to pay attention and hear from God tonight. In Luke 10, 38 to 42, where it talks about Martha and Mary, Martha works hard to welcome Jesus into her home. Her sister Mary of Bethany simply sits at his feet and listens to what Jesus has to say. Both Mary and Martha serve, but Mary understands the priority and necessity of choosing to abide with Christ. That's what we need to do. When we sit at the table, we need to abide in Christ. When we come to the communion table tonight, we come together as sisters and brothers in the Lord. We can't be worried about what someone else is doing or what they may have. You have to examine yourself. You have to look closely, as Pastor Bethel was saying this morning, you got to look deeper into yourself. You need to examine yourself to make sure that you're right with the Lord. Jesus offers the bread and the cup to all God's children who believe that he died and rose from the grave and ascended into heaven. Only one thing is necessary, and that is to give your attention to the one who paid for your seat at the table. In other words, you need to keep your eyes on the prize. You need to keep your eyes focused on the one who paid for your seat. I can't go to my friend, sit at his table, and be on my phone all night. I can't be going around talking to everybody and not, you know, paying attention. I can't be a distraction because now it's a bad reflection on him. I got to pay attention. I got to focus on what's going on. In Philippians 3, 13 and 14, it says, brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call in God, in Christ Jesus. See, I can't be looking back at the past relationships or memories and failures and temptations or anything that might distract from a single-minded focus on the upward call of Christ. See, we're not at the old table anymore. We're at a new table now because we have a new covenant in the blood of Jesus. So what's the third thing then? You've accepted the invitation. We're trying to pay attention. I know it's hard. We got so many things going on, but we need to pay attention. The third thing we need to do then is we have to know the amount of the cost of that seat at the table. In that series, the Father was willing to do whatever it took to protect his land, to provide an inheritance. I mean, he steal, kill, cheat, deceive, anything to provide for his family. But the one thing I don't think he was willing to do, I don't think he was willing to lay down his life for his land. Because if he died, his family, his children, you know, they weren't really fighting for his property like he was. It was going to go wherever. So he had to do everything he could to stay alive. But see, we have a Savior who willingly died for us. He died so that we might have a seat. In 1 Corinthians 11, 24 and 25, let me back up for a second. My wife's going to look at me when I tell this, but some years ago, when Bill Clinton was running for president, she wanted to volunteer for the campaign. And at the time, I was working for the government, and y'all know that little thing that this past administration didn't pay attention to, the Hatch Act. Well, because I worked for the government, I could not volunteer for the campaign. But this particular day, he's coming in, and I decided to go with her. And for some reason, I put on a dark suit and a white shirt and a red tie, and I go out, you know, and we're there early, and people are asking me where they need to be and what's going here and what's going there. And I'm like, why did they thought I was part of the advanced team, and I, you know, So my wife goes to the guy. She says, look, I just want to get his autograph. And he kept saying, I'm shorthanded. I need people. I need people. So he kept looking at me like, and I kept saying, I can't do. I can't do. So I got to kind of lay out the scenario. So finally, I said, okay, whatever. I just can't be. And good thing it's not like now where it got cameras all over the place. There were no cameras out there, so I didn't have to worry about being seen. So they set it up for my wife to be the first person that Clinton would see as he gets off the L. They put me down at the bottom, so when he got off the L, I'm holding back the city officials. So he gets off the L, he goes straight to the street. He bypassed my wife, he bypassed me. So next thing you know, we're in the street. And we're walking behind, and I'm walking behind Secret Service. I'm just walking, you know, hey. I walk maybe 3 blocks until they recognize, hey, you're not one of us. So we had to tell him what we wanted to do, and we got what we wanted. So as a result of her volunteering for the campaign, we get put on this mailing list. And if any of you know, when you do something for a campaign and you get on a list, you get all these invitations. Well, we got put on the A list for somehow. I don't know how we got the A list, but we were just getting invitation after invitation. I get a phone call, hey, come to the White House for this dinner. Okay, yeah, we're going. And they call back a day or two later and say, oh, by the way, it's $500 a plate, it's $1,000 a plate, it's $1,500 a plate. Oh, you know what? Something just came up at work. I can't do that. I can't afford that plate. So about 2 years in, the DNC calls and said, hey, we got a free luncheon to come. So I can do free, yes. So I accepted the free seat at the table because I couldn't afford the price of what it costs to sit at the table. But we have a Lord and Savior who paid the price that made it free for us to sit at the table. Because when he died, that was our ticket that put our name on the seat. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. That was the price that was paid for your seat. Similarly, when supper had ended, he took the cup saying, this is the new covenant, which was ratified and established. When you ratify something, when you establish something, that means it's set. It is put in place. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So what does that mean? That means that our seat was sanctioned by God when he sent Jesus as our sacrifice. It was approved by Jesus' death when he got up from the grave. It was authorized by the Holy Spirit when we confess and repent of our sins, and it was confirmed when you partake of communion and do it in remembrance of what it cost. Jesus willingly died for us. In Romans 5, 6, it says, you see, at just the right time, at just the right time, I got the right call to take a free seat at the table. At just the right time, Jesus died so that you might have a seat at the table. Otherwise, it would have cost you your life. Jesus died while we were still powerless, and he died for the ungodly. It was his sacrifice that bought your seat. That was the cost of your seat. And you need to know that it was free to you. It cost him everything. It cost him his life, but for you, it's just a decision. To accept him to come into your life, to confess that he's Lord and believe that he died, and you have a seat at the table. Now that you've accepted the invitation, you've paid attention, you know the amount, and the last thing you have to do is you have to appreciate the value of your seat at the table. Every time we take communion, we should remember what Jesus did. He gave up his place in heaven. He was seated already at the right hand of the Father, but because of our fall, because of the sin, he said, send me, God. I'll go down. I'll put on a suit of flesh, and I'll walk the earth for 33 years, and I'll be sinless, but I'll become sin so that they can have a seat at the table. In 1 Corinthians 11, 24 and 25, again, Jesus' command extends beyond just that special night. It wasn't a one and done. No, it's every time that we take communion, we need to think about and appreciate what Jesus did for us. He said that this is my body. Every time we do it, we need to appreciate the fact that his body was broken for us. And this cup, the new covenant in his blood, every time we do that, we agree with what he did. Because we take it, hopefully, in the right way, in the right manner. The text doesn't say so, but I believe whenever we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we're sharing a covenant meal at Jesus' table. We eat his bread and drink his wine, and so renew our commitment to the new covenant he established over 2,000 years ago. The Lord's Supper is the new covenant in Jesus' death. For us as Christians, it should cause us to remember what he did on the cross, reflect how much it cost, recommit yourselves by presenting your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. If Jesus could hang on a cross and die for us, can we not just worship him and say thank you for what he did on the cross for us? Can we not just magnify him because of what he did? Can we not lift him up because of what he did for us? We couldn't do it on our own. We need to reconnect our lives to him by keeping our eyes on the prize, and we need to repent by examining ourselves and confessing our sins. You mothers, whenever your children came to eat, what was the one thing you told them to do before they eat?
Wash your hands.
If we confess and repent of our sins, what does Jesus do? He washes our hands and cleanses our heart so that we can come to the table with clean hands and a pure heart. So we need to appreciate what Jesus has done for us. When you go to a fine restaurant, the maitre d' is going to ask, how many is in your party? Follow me, I'll show you to your table. And he's going to sit you at a table that is a sign for you. But when you accepted the invitation to dine at Jesus' table, he's taking you to the master's table, to a seat that has your name on it, that has a specific place setting just for you. Nobody else can sit in your seat. Nobody else can use what you have at your table because it's specifically designed and paid for you. It was paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter who's at the table as long as you know that you're sitting at the right table because you were bought with a price. It doesn't matter about the table if it has formal wear, plastic wear. Jesus provides all that you need. He'll bring the bread. He says, I'm the bread of life, and whoever eats the bread will never go hungry or thirsty again. Every time you take your seat at the master's table, it should cause you to reflect back on what Jesus did on the cross so that you could have a seat at the table. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's praise the Lord for what he did for us on Calvary over 2,000 years ago. He died that we might be able to have a seat at the table each and every time we take communion. Tonight, there may be someone here who's not asked, who hasn't received an invitation yet, but the Lord has been drawing you to come and have a seat at his table. I'd like to give you an opportunity to accept that invitation tonight. I'm going to say a simple prayer. You repeat that prayer, and you'll have your invitation. You'll have your seat. You'll have your name on your seat. It's a seat that you'll never lose. You'll always be able to sit at that seat. Nobody will be able to sit in your chair. We have the seats here, and every Sunday somebody might be sitting in your seat and you get upset. But when Jesus sits you at his table, nobody else can sit in your table. So with every eye closed and every head bowed, if there's anyone under the sound of my voice would like to accept that invitation tonight, I'd like to invite you to come down. Meet me here at the altar. We'll say a simple prayer, and you'll have your seat at the table. For those of you who are viewing online, you can repeat this prayer as well. Lord Jesus, I need you. Thank you, Lord, for coming into my life and saving me. Lord, I believe that you died for me and was buried and rose on the third day for my justification. Thank you for coming into my life and saving me. If you've prayed that prayer, if you would call the church and ask for Pastor Clarence Taylor, he will share some information with you to confirm your decision that you made tonight. Amen? Amen.
The way I will open up my heart to thank you.
1 Corinthians 11 reminds us that as we prepare to take the offering, take the communion, we are to make sure that we examine ourselves. The purpose of examination is that we take it in right relationship with our Lord and Savior. I want to take a moment just to ask the Lord to forgive us of any unconfessed sin, that we might be in the right relationship, that we might restore relationship with Christ as we enter into this communion table. Amen? So, Father, we thank you for your blood that was shed. We thank you, Lord, that if it was just one person, you still would have died. We thank you, Lord, that you suffered and died and shed your blood for us. And we ask, Lord, now that you would, as we enter into this communion ceremony, Lord, we're not taking it out of ceremonial. We're coming in a relationship. And ask, Lord, that you would restore our relationship with you. You would cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And, Lord, prepare our hearts and minds as we take this communion tonight. Lord, that we would be spiritually refreshed, that we would renew our commitment to you, and that we would understand, as the preacher said, the cost of what you did for us, and that we have a seat at the table. We ask these blessings in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. I would ask now that Deacon Richardson, if you would pray over the bread, and Deacon Sullivan, if you pray over the cup.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, Father, we thank you, Lord, for salvation, Lord. And Father, we thank you, Lord, down on the cross for our sins. Father, we pray, Lord, you might just bless this bread, which stands for your body, which is broken for us, Lord. And Father, we just rededicate ourselves to you. For in Jesus' name we pray and for his sake. Amen.
Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy. We thank you, Lord, for another opportunity, Lord, to have a seat at the table. We just pray, Lord, that you just, we just ask you, Lord, to just bless this juice, Lord, as a representation of the blood that was shed on Calvary for us, Lord. We don't take it lightly, Lord. We pray all these things in Jesus Christ's name for sake. Amen.
You know the road is rough and the going gets tough and the hills are hard to climb. I started out a long time ago. There is no doubt in my mind. I've decided to make Jesus my choice. Oh, you know the road is rough and the going gets tough and the hills are hard to climb. because you cared for me in such a special way. That's why I praise you, I lift you up, and I magnify your name. That's why my heart is filled with praise. My heart, my mind, my soul belongs to you. You paid the price for me way back on Calvary. That's why
everybody that desires to be served, have you been served? If you have not, please, ma'am, please, sir, raise your hand and we will come to you. Amen.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show
so sad. He rose again. Remember we celebrated last? He's alive, amen? This is like a celebratory moment. It's not a funeral, amen? Amen. That's better. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, it didn't look good. Jesus broke bread and he gave it to his disciples, gave thanks and gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is now my body, which is given for you. Take ye all of it and eat it in remembrance of me." Let us eat together. In the same manner, he took the cup. Say, "This is the blood, the New Testament, which is given for you. Take ye all and drink of it in remembrance of me." This represents the New Testament, New Covenant. Let us drink together. And as we eat and drink together, we've also committed ourselves again to the Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen?
How to reach the masses, men of every birth, for an answer, Jesus gave the key.
Eric always want to tease us like that, you know what I'm saying? Amen, amen. I think the deacons are almost done. Yeah, they're done. I was going to let you go a little bit longer, but we can worship afterwards. Amen. It's been a good day. Amen.
Yeah.
Let's all stand for the benediction. Now unto him who's able to keep you from falling, to present you faultless before his throne with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be majesty, dominion, and power both now and forevermore. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Amen. You are dismissed.